Koutou, good evening and welcome to this webinar about Auckland Council's 10-year budget from 2021 to 2031 with a special focus on rates. This 10-year budget will respond to the impacts of climate change, protect our environment and continue to provide essential and key services to Aucklanders. The budget also sets out our commitment to prudent management of our finances and a continued focus on savings to manage the loss of council income from COVID-19. From the Governance Division of Te Kaunihera o Tāmaki Makaurau, my name is Iri Tuiavi'i and it's indeed my pleasure to be your host this evening. In no particular order, joining me tonight to kōrero about tonight's kaupapa are Desley Simpson, Councillor for the Ōrākei Ward and Chairperson of the Finance and Performance Committee. Tāla whālawa to you, Councillor Simpson. Pippa Coombe, Deputy Chair of Environment and Climate Change and Councillor for the Waitamata Ward. Kia ora, Councillor Coombe. Angela Dalton, Councillor for the Manurewa Papakura Ward and Liaison Councillor for the Māori Portfolio. Tēnā koe to you, Councillor Dalton, this evening. Venturing further south, I'd like to introduce to you Bill Cashmore, the Deputy Mayor and Councillor for the Franklin Ward. Good evening, Deputy Mayor Cashmore. Hopping across a few postcodes to the west, I'd like to introduce Shane Henderson, Councillor for the Henderson-Massey Ward. Kia ora, Councillor Henderson. Last but certainly not least of our councillors, Christine Fletcher, Councillor for the Albert Eden Puketapapa Ward, and who holds the Parks and Open Spaces Portfolio. A very good evening indeed to you, Councillor Fletcher. Now, look, I'm mindful that using this platform is a bit of a new thing for some of us, and so I just want to go around and see if I've missed any of our lovely elected members before introducing the rest of the staff. It would seem not. The finance team tonight, this evening, are ably represented by Andrew Duncan, who is the Manager of Financial Policy. Ma lōlisu fō maua malelangi mamā to you, Andrew. But again, our biggest welcome is to those of you, the members of our public, who have taken the time to tune in to our kōrero this evening. This evening's webinar will take about 90 minutes. It will be recorded and made available on the website, alongside questions and responses to these. As a reminder, if you've not already done so, visit akhaveyoursay.nz/recoverybudget and check out the resources available there, as well as the portal for making your submission. At various points throughout the webinar, panelists will refer to the consultation document. This can also be found at the same web address, akhaveyoursay.nz/recoverybudget. Momentarily, I will invite our subject matter expert, Andrew Duncan, to make a brief presentation about tonight's kaupapa. While we get that screen share going or prepared, I'd like to point out that the immediate financial challenges require a suite of urgent measures to be enacted. One such measure is the focus of the PowerPoint presentation you will now be given. But to kick off the presentation, you'll get an opportunity to hear from His Worship Mayor Phil Goff by way of a short video. Thank you.
This year is the year of recovery from COVID-19. We stopped the spread of the disease, but the economic impact and hit on council revenue was real. This 10-year budget is about how we get the best outcomes for Auckland. It will provide for our city's future while keeping our rates increases low compared to other growth cities in New Zealand. We'll help Auckland's economy recover, support our communities, build water and housing infrastructure, and improve our transport network. We'll continue to make progress on cleaning up our beaches and streams and on our long-term response to climate change. Auckland Council is forecast to take a $1 billion revenue hit because of COVID-19. This budget aims to find a balance between investing in our city and not overburdening our residents. We need your feedback on these issues and how we pay for them. To have your say, go to akhaveyoursay.nz/recoverybudget and tell us what you think of our plans for the future of Auckland.
Sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. We're just going to switch across now to the PowerPoint presentation to be given by Andrew Duncan. While that's being loaded, I'd just like to remind you folks that you're able to ask a question through the Q&A function, which we'll turn our attention to in about 10 minutes. The PowerPoint is almost up and ready for us. While we give that a moment, Councillor Cashmore, I understand that this budget was an agonising one, and I understand it took the elected members around 77 hours to hold deliberations around this. Could you comment about A, the significance of this budget, and B, how incredibly important it is for us to hear from our community? Councillor Cashmore.
Thanks very much, Eddie, and hi to everybody who's online, and a special thank you to our staff for their time this evening. It's very real, this COVID stuff, and it's no more real than we're seeing it tonight. The challenges have been incredible, and Council has faced the challenges alongside the public of Auckland and New Zealand, and the businesses of Auckland and New Zealand. And the hit is quite substantial. So for us, we've got a $1 billion hit over for 4 years. And that is going to mean we have to make some really hard calls, which is why it's so important we hear back from the public. What services do we retain? What services do we minimise? What services do we look at trimming? What is essential to people and what is critical? How is our economy going to pivot in Auckland to face the fact that we're not going to have tourism for a while? They may not even have students, offshore students, for a while. So we have to encounter all these things, and we have to face up the reality that the COVID world is real. And we have to be smart how we go and challenge that. So I'm really looking forward to hearing from the responses from the people who have got some positive solutions, some ideas, some concepts, and some new realities for us to deliver Auckland into the future, post-COVID, an economic downturn, and looking for a bright and positive future for New Zealand's biggest city. Thanks, Eddie.
Thank you, Councillor Cashmore. We're just having a few difficulties with our PowerPoint, so we'll keep going with these comments from our elected members. I could be wrong. Marina, could you give us a thumbs up if we're good to go? Not quite. I've got a question here for Councillor Simpson. Councillor Simpson, you'll recall at our emergency budget webinar series last year, we talked about making savings of between $90 and $120 million here at Council. Would you be able to give us an update how we're tracking? Are we likely to meet that savings target? Are we quite some way off it? Councillor Simpson, some comments from you regarding that, if you will.
Sure. Look, the emergency budget, as you've said, had a savings target of $120 million, and that was outstandingly huge, the highest ever in Auckland Council's history. And if you sort of think of what is $120 million worth, it's sort of over a 7% rates increase. It's huge. But as of the end of January, we're tracking well over $100 million now, and so we believe that we're absolutely on track to deliver that $120 million worth of savings. And I think that's really important. You know, before we put our hand out to anybody else, we've got to really show that we're doing our bit to actually create more efficiencies and deliver a better operating model than what we've had before. Going forward into the LTP, we have, of course, $90 million going through continuously through that, through our LTP proposal, and that is about a 5% rates increase, really, over 5%. So, yep, I think the savings targets are significant. The 120, as I said, the highest ever we've had in the history of Auckland Council, and $90 million a year will be the second highest.
Kia ora, thank you very much, Councillor. My apologies, Andrew. I understand that we've had the issue sorted. Take three. Andrew Duncan, over to you.
Good evening. This is not a business as usual budget. The Council, like so many others, is feeling significant impacts of COVID-19. We're projecting to lose around $1 billion in revenue over the next 4 years. Meanwhile, we still need to plan for the projected growth of the city and to look after the infrastructure that delivers the services we all value. We all need to face up to the challenges of climate change, both in terms of emission reduction and adaption to a changing climate. This is why we're referring to this as our recovery budget. So what are the challenges we face on the next slide? We can look at five key issues. Now, our challenges, the real challenge behind this budget is one of balance. On the one hand, an increased need for council investment, but on the other, less availability of funds to make this investment. I've already mentioned Auckland's growth, infrastructure needs, and climate change, but we also need to continue the work we have started on our transport network. We need to ensure our activities match the changing needs of our people, and we need to play our part in supporting recovery from COVID-19. At the same time, we have less capacity to invest. We've talked about the reductions in expected revenue due to COVID, but we also need to be careful how much we borrow and ensure we have headroom for any future shocks. Large sections of our funding is already committed through major projects such as the CRL or the Central Interceptor. We also need to consider the overall impact of funding options we propose on the community we serve. So our proposed investment package is looking across five key issues. First issue is the investment package, essentially our response to balancing in the last slide. We're proposing to invest $31 million over the next 10 years. This includes $900 million for investment in the next 3 years. The timing of this investment is crucial given the challenges we are facing. Our proposal enables this investment to average $2.9 billion for the next 3 years, total $900 million that we would otherwise be able to afford. To achieve this, we will continue our focus on savings and value and lock in at least $90 million of permanent ongoing annual savings, Councillor Simpson just referred to. As we did in the emergency budget, we will look to release $70 million a year over the next 3 years by selling, leasing surplus properties. We're going to increase our borrowing to a temporarily higher debt-to-revenue ratio of up to 290% for the first 3 years, gradually returning to 270% thereafter, and stick with rates increases of 3.5% over the long term, but have a higher increase 5% for next year. Now, with this additional investment on the next slide, you can see $550 million extra for Auckland's transport network. We're going to accelerate the removal of renewal. $54 million additional funding for stormwater infrastructure, and $65 million for community and parks, and deliver sports parks capacity in the areas of greatest need. The next slide, we're looking to address health and safety concerns around closed landfill sites and earlier restoration of the Art Gallery Heritage Building. The next key issue is responding to climate change. Not down to the council to tackle climate change on our own. We want to lead from the front. We're already doing a lot of work to tackle emissions, including phasing out gas boilers in council aquatic centres, introducing more electric vehicles to council's fleet, and providing walking, cycling, and public transport options. But in addition, the package includes no new diesel buses, all electric or hydrogen from next year. This is part of this extra $150 million of investment funded by the rates increase. We've got big planting projects, including street trees and more native forest, increasing our zero waste recovery resource network, improving efficiency of our facilities, and partnering with others and supporting our communities to reduce emissions as well as energy costs. But we've also got to respond to housing and growth. So our growth investment on the next slide, we're expecting 260,000 more people to call Auckland home. Now, the unitary plans enable development of more than a million homes in existing residential area and 137,000 in urban areas. We need to provide infrastructure and services to support this development. We can't afford to do it without. So we're proposing to focus our resources on a few key locations. Areas agreed with the government as part of the Auckland Housing Program, like Mount Roskill, Tamaki and Mangere, where there's other significant government investment plans, such as Drury and areas of the Northwest, and where investment like big projects like the CRL is being made. But along with growth, we've got to invest in our existing community. And we need to be more adaptable in how we provide community services. So the next slide talks about traditionally, we've provided community services using a large network of building and properties. Many of these reflect what we were doing 50 years ago, and we've changed since that time. We need to become more adaptable in how we provide these services to keep up with the changing needs of the city, people who live here. Much of our investment is locked in to aging community buildings, facilities, spending more on renewals and maintenance. And this detracts from what we can spend delivering the services Aucklanders need. The recovery budget's proposing a move away from an asset-dominated approach to community services. We propose to consider how to better use partnerships, grants, digital and non-asset-based approach more tailored to community needs. Over time, the implementation of this new approach would see us closing some assets that aren't fit for purpose and reinvesting in services and facilities to better meet the needs of our community. We also have to invest in the environment. In the previous budget, accelerated actions to improve water quality in the natural environment. This was funded by the water quality targeted rate and the natural environment targeted rate. We're proposing to extend and increase this investment so we can continue to invest in different parts of the city. Now, the budget proposes to extend the water quality targeted rate past its end date of 2028 until 2031. So we can continue to invest in different parts of the city. And we're also proposing to increase this rate in line with the projected average increase in general rates. So that's 5% in the first year and 3.5% later years. This will be an increase in the average value residential property of $3.30 a year for water quality rate. This will enable us, this increased revenue and the longer time period, will enable us to extend our water quality work to do more in the Manukau Harbour, Tamaki Estuary, and the beaches stretching from Parnell to Glendowen. And for construction to start in 2022-23, rather than 6 years later. It will also fund additional litter traps across the entire region to remove contaminants and improve freshwater and coastal water. We're also going to extend the natural environment targeted rate. The moment this expires in 2028, we're looking to extend that to 2031. That means that the work we're doing to address kauri dieback and to deal with possums and weed control will be able to continue. Now, we have some other priorities as well. With regard to Māori outcomes, the Council's committed to a treaty-based partnership with Māori. We will enable delivery against 10 Māori outcomes strategic priorities through our Māori outcomes portfolio. This portfolio includes our day-to-day activities, supplemented with targeted use of the Māori Outcomes Fund, $150 million investment over the next 10 years. Examples include the Marae Infrastructure Program, which helps Marae to be healthy, sustainable cultural hubs, Ngā Kete Akaranga is our cultural capability program. Te Kete Ruku Ruku is returning names to parks and places across Tamaki Makaurau and helps ensure the Māori language is seen, heard, spoken, learnt in everyday life. The recovery budget's reinstating the contestable funds, which were reduced as part of the emergency budget for this year. We're also proposing to embed a $500,000 annual operational to work with other organisations to support homelessness. Continued work with the Southern Initiative and Western Initiative to help disadvantaged sections of our community with skills training and employment pathways. So this, the other side of the balance in this packet is the impact on rates. So we're proposing a one-off increase of 5% to help support the investment Auckland needs, and then 3.5% per year after. Now, for the average value residential property in Auckland of $1.08 million, that will mean an increase of $150 per year. Now, that includes the increase of $3.30 in the water quality targeted rate. And for the average value business property, $500. For your individual property, you can go onto our website at this web address and see what that rates increases that are being proposed would mean for your property. And that'll show you the different components of the changes. Some properties may be affected by some other rates changes, and I'll talk about those now. At present, properties, residential and business properties in the rural areas pay 90% of the cents in the dollar. It's multiplied by the property's value to establish their general rates payment. These properties are differentiated from urban properties by our urban rating area. We set this 10 years ago. The city has grown a lot since then, and urban levels of service are available to the properties that have been developed just outside the boundary and in some of the neighbouring townships. So we're proposing to extend urban rating area to cover all land where urban development is permitted. This doesn't include Warkworth, as the service levels haven't reached similar levels to urban Auckland in that area yet. Now, farm and lifestyle properties, wherever they are located in the Auckland region, pay 80% of the cents in the dollar to multiply your property's value by. This includes farm and lifestyle property within the urban rating area that can be developed for residential use, business use. We're proposing to rate these properties at the urban residential rate. So farm and lifestyle properties that can be developed in the urban rating area, proposal is that they would pay urban residential rate. What these two proposals mean is that properties with similar access to services will pay similar rates to their neighbours. Other proposed rating changes. Last year, when our borders were closed, the council reduced its expenditure on visitor attraction, major events and destination parking. Council has accommodation provide a targeted rate, which has motels, hotels, and Airbnb properties make a contribution to that expenditure. In response to the closure of borders and international visitors stopping being able to come to Auckland, we reduced the spending and suspended the rate for a year. We're consulting this year on when we should reintroduce that rate, and there are three options on the table. The end of that first year suspension, 1st of April, or on the 1st of January 2022, or the 1st of July 2022. Having these three options on the table events, the councillors will be able to consider the feedback from the community in response to this consultation we're going through now, and all the latest information on when borders are likely to open again, and visitors will be able to come to our city. We're also proposing to introduce a electricity network resilience targeted rate. It'll be paid by Vector. We will use the money from that rate to enhance our management of our trees near their power lines. This will improve the public safety around power lines and also electricity supply security. Rate will only be paid. We also have a city centre targeted rate. We use the funds from this to make additional investments in the city centre, make it an attractive place to work, live and visit. This rate expires in 2024-25. It's only paid by city centre business properties. We're proposing to extend that until 2030-31. So that we can continue our expanded investment program city centre. We're also consulting on introducing a bus service between Paremaremo and Albany to allow Paremaremo residents to connect to the wider public transport network. This will be funded under the proposal by a targeted rate on the residents in the area. There's quite a lot of material I've just gone through. You can find out more about that by attending a webinar like this. There's opportunities to provide feedback online. We want as many people as possible from all of Auckland's communities to have a say in the process. There's difficult decisions and balances to be made, and your views are an important part of that. Background documents are available online at our service centres and libraries. Post them out to you. They're available in several languages. You can also give us your views on social media through our website, AKA Have Your Say, as I noted on the previous slide. There's other avenues on the next slide. Very much looking forward to hearing your views. It's an important part of our decision making. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andrew. I noticed that the question machine is well and truly fired up, which is terrific, and we'll come to those momentarily. I did, however, note from a couple of our elected members that there are some comments that you wanted to make or some questions in particular that you wanted to pick up and speak to. So I'll start with you, Councillor Henderson, if we've got you there on the line, if you'd like
to. Yeah, thank you. Question. Yeah, have you got me?
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, wonderful. So, I just wanted to say there's a couple of questions I've seen in here around core business. And I think, firstly, that's totally a valid concern. And in a lot of cases, a lot of the questions we're going to have tonight are actually around the services people value, saying, look, I value this, but not that. I think that's part of our discussion on what's a core business of council. And it's certainly something that, as councillors, we've raised repeatedly as we've gone through this process. And I think, you know, as part of this budget, we've got to look at it and say, look, this is a service that we want council to deliver and we really value. This is one that we don't necessarily value. But also one last thing on that is when we're talking about rates, we're also talking about service levels. And if we're asking to lower a service level in an activity due to cost, I think that's a perfectly valid piece of feedback. But just to be aware that some people will value a service and some people won't. That's just kind of the nature of it all. But I think we're always open to that conversation. And just really appreciate people bringing their views on what council should be doing.
Thank you, Shane. Councillor Dalton, you wanted to speak to this one as well, or has Shane covered it all off?
No, I will add something. Thank you, Eddie. And what we're experiencing is the impact of using 49% of ratepayers' money to fund council's operations, and the remaining 51% that has significantly impacted us comes from alternative revenues like airport shares, port shares, public transport, and other user charges. So what councillors have top of mind is to not continue to burden our ratepayers, but what we're experiencing is the impact of what happens when we are not 100% funded by rates. And the other thing, I'll support Shane, that councillors continue to talk about our priorities. What is our business? We need to look at our business, and that discussion is about to take place in the next few months, and it's a valid question that we need to do that, and we will respond. Thank you. Thanks, Eddie.
Thank you, Langela. Councillor Coombe, you wanted to get in there as well.
Kia ora. Thank you, Eddie. Good evening, everybody. I see there's quite a few questions coming through about our climate action, so I thought I could make a few comments about that. So for the first time in the 10-year budget, we have got some funds allocated to specific climate action. And one of the questions is, why are we making that a priority? Well, we did declare a climate emergency in 2019, and we signed off a climate plan, an all of Auckland climate plan. And that is looking to all sectors to get behind climate action, not just council. But we have to walk the talk, and we need to show leadership, just as we expect that from government and business, iwi, the community, is all contributing. So there was a question there about some of that funding. Where is it going? And particularly on EV buses. So the proposal is that we will have new buses, all new buses, will be electric or hydrogen powered from 2021 rather than 2025 as previously planned. And there is a page in the consultation material at page 30 that's worth checking out for some of the other actions that we're proposing. Of course, that 150 million that is tacked to climate action isn't the only funding that we have towards climate action, but because it's more of a holistic picture. So there's lots of other things that we're doing that contribute in terms of our investment in our water, transport, community facilities, parks, across the board, all make a difference. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. I'm going to come to Councillor Cashmere in a moment. I noticed that in our questions, we've got you asking about how you make your submission. Again, that email, that web address, sorry, is akhaveyoursay.nz/recoverybudget. Councillor Cashmere, you recall that a lot of the feedback at the emergency budget webinars last year and some of the questions were of a similar nature. Tonight, we're getting these kinds of questions as well. So I thought if you wanted to comment, and it's quite simply put, and I think it also speaks to how our community feels. And the comment is, if the budget is so short of funds, so if council is so short of funds, why don't we just stop all expenditure and stick to core services until budget is balanced, instead of just borrowing more and more? Why don't we just stop expenditure, Councillor Cashmere? Have you any thoughts about that?
Well, Eddie, we could certainly do that. We could shut your library, your local park, we won't mow it, we won't fix the repairs to your playground, we won't fix roading potholes, and if your water line to your house doesn't work, well, that won't be repaired, or your sewage line away from your house doesn't work, that won't be repaired. So if you think of all the things where council touches you, we pick up your rubbish, we supply you with water, you have community facilities, we can go and do yoga or taekwondo or whatever else happens there. You have a library, you have sports fields, you have swimming pools, you have a whole raft of council supplied activities, from public transport to playgrounds. Council touches everyone's life in a multiple number of ways every day. And everyone treasures those services, but often think that they're connected back to what they pay in their rates bill. We've tried to strike a balance between refining and making cost savings by using our scale and scope to have smarter procurement to reduce costs, but also to try and keep supplying the key services that Aucklanders love and cherish. I saw one of the comments in the chat bar was about, why do we make people go and pay to visit the art gallery? Why do we make people go and pay and visit the museum, the sports field, the kids' playground? Why don't we make public transport 100% cost recovery? Because there is an economic balance that has to be made between public good and economic return. And that's a really hard call that every person sitting on a local board or around the council chamber has to make. And it's not easy. It's a balance between what is required, what is necessary, and what is potentially it can be taken or it can be given. And everyone has an opinion on that. And we as elected members, with our responsibility back to our communities, to our city, and indeed to our country, have to make a call on what is the right thing to do. So Eddie, it's very easy to make some very simplistic calls about we'll do this and not that, but not everyone's going to agree with that. And that's not often the best way to do it. So why don't we just together take everyone's views? They're coming through tonight thick and fast, and that's great. And just find that balance, because that balance will be probably in the right place. And also a lot of people sort of quote back, I was better back in the good old days. When you actually look hard at the good old days, pre-amalgamation, they actually weren't that flash. We had huge problems with infrastructure. There was no coordination. It wasn't linked together. And what we've done in the past 10 years, we've had a huge population increase of over 300,000 people. Yet our hard cash savings are over 300 million. We've delivered record amounts of infrastructure and community assets such as parks. But we've also lost a little bit of the local, and we have to be mindful of that. Big is good in some ways, but also we have to remind ourselves that the local community, no matter whether it's the Auckland city centre or a little wee town or a village on the coast of Franklin or Rodney, are equally important. So we have to deliver for all those people. And that makes the job very complex and difficult. This budget's been hit by COVID-driven impacts, but we have a scale in this city that's not replicated anywhere else in New Zealand that we can actually still continue to deliver, that helps keep employment up, helps keep the economy going, delivers things for our communities. Though it might not be as much as we would like, it is still delivering. And we need to continue on that focus of doing what we absolutely can within the fiscal and prudent responsibilities which we elected to deliver. Thanks, Eddie.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Mayor Cashmore. I'm going across to Councillor Fletcher in a moment, but just a quick prompt to our elected members. You'll notice down in our Q&A, we're quite spoilt for choice in terms of the questions and the areas that they cover. So if you could please just pop in there, have a look and indicate via the chat which of those you might wish to address, that'd be fantastic. Councillor Fletcher, over to you.
Oh, thank you, Eddie. I want to touch on some of the things that Bill has referred to. You know, the city has to remain functional. We can't allow for a dysfunctional city. I think the other thing that people really need to understand is that we have to honour the existing contracts. CRL is huge, and we can't just suddenly decide to go and walk away from it. The thing that I would say is that the budget is attempting to grapple with the vexed issue of renewals. And somebody in the talk bar here is asking questions around maintenance. It's something that I feel passionately about. And I think that even with or without COVID, I don't actually look at this and say recovery budget. I look at this and say this budget is attempting to grapple with things that we should have dealt with for quite a long time in and around the renewals area. The thing that hasn't been said is as we try and find that balance between growth and existing services and so forth, the role and the relationship with central government. I am really tired of the chest beating that goes on about our failure to deliver houses. We could deliver houses tomorrow if we could get that partnership. And I'm not saying this in a political way. I think it's just as much of a problem under National as it is with Labour, but we need a better funding relationship with central government. It's improving in the area of transport, but there's still some naivety in terms of what it will take before we can actually move sensibly forward. And finally, on that issue of public good, I care really passionately about parks. And I know a lot of people who are paying a lot in rates and the issue of affordability for them. And the question they should be asking is, are we leveraging sufficiently well off our balance sheet? But I wouldn't want to see the investment that we've made in our regional park network, which is probably more impacting on us in a positive sense than the Department of Conservation does. We've got to continue to do those things because they're for our children, they're for the future. And you're always going to find with art galleries, these sorts of things, they can have, as the museum does, exhibitions from time to time that are paid. But we actually provide those because it enhances, it brings cohesion to our community. So do I think that it's palatable to have such a big one-off rate increase? I don't know. I want to hear from you this evening. But it isn't just about COVID. There are a whole bunch of other things that we need to do, which are a direct result of amalgamation and actually coming to grips with maintenance of the wider Auckland region. We have spent hours and hours and hours on this. And so it will be really important to hear back from you what you think of what we've dished up.
Thank you, Councillor Fletcher. Councillor Simpson. Might just get you unmute there, sorry, Councillor.
Sorry about that. Thank you. I had to unmute my button. Look, I just want to support Councillor Fletcher in her comments around renewals. Because, you know, the mistake that a council can make is it's all good to build nice new shiny stuff, but what about the existing stuff you've got? You've sort of got to look after that as well. So just give some financial context around that. Our renewals are up 50% from the last LTP and 75% from the one before. So out of our $5.2 billion increase in capital program compared to the last LTP, so that's $31.4 billion up from $26.2, 75% of that increase is for renewals. And that's, you know, as I said, I share Councillor Fletcher's concern, and I think that's one of the positive things that we're offering Aucklanders, that support around the renewals budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Simpson. I've got a question here, and just indicate which of you elected members would like to answer this. And it comes up time and time again. And it's along the lines of, as a community, they're all concerned. It's the future of Tāmaki Makaurau. They want to have their say, they want to make a submission, but the general sense out there is, well, what for? The elected members don't listen to us. And you'll be familiar with this kind of rhetoric that was fed back to us last year during the emergency budget webinars. And you know, whoever would like to address this, does the community making a submission actually matter? What's the process? What happens to the submission? Is this the only consideration that you base your decision-making deliberations off of, or are there other considerations? Elected members, first in, please. Councillor Cashmore.
I'll be very brief and let my fellow councillors have a say, but the feedback from the public is absolutely crucial. I'm monitoring this chat bar continuously and writing down notes in my book about what people are saying. We need to hear from you about what you think is critical and what you think is expendable. We need to hear from you about what do you think we should be focusing on and what we should not be focusing on. Your views do matter. And sometimes you might feel at the end of the day, your opinions weren't heard. Well, that is the wash up that we have to face with the decision making that we have to make. And that's a real hard challenge. You know, I would like rates increases to be minus 10, but it's not feasible, it's not practical. It would cause huge unemployment and put our infrastructure delivery back 40 years. We've had enough of that. We have to actually deliver what is best for the economy of the city and for the people of the city. So let's just, you know, put your feedback through. Think about it, be rational and be constructive, because the alternative is not flash, and we need to actually have good positive outcomes for the city. Thanks, Eddie.
Thanks, Councillor Cashmore. I've got a supplementary for you before I hand over to Councillor Dalton. And the question here, or the comment, speaks to the precedent of just extending the duration of the targeted rates just reinforces a view that this is a general rates increase introduced by stealth. Have you a comment to make on that, please, Councillor Cashmore, and then I'll come to you, Councillor Dalton.
Yeah, thanks, Eddie. It's a really good point. The targeted rates are introduced to actually focus down on certain key issues, whether it's environmental quality, water quality, or transport. And I was involved in the initial transport rate because Auckland Council back in 2010-13 was balancing its books by cutting the Auckland transport budget. And we had to actually prove to the government at the time, John Key's government, that we were committed to putting our hand in our own pocket or in our ratepayers' pocket. You know, I'm a ratepayer, to fund transport. And that's when we introduced the first targeted rate, which was the transport levy. Popular or unpopular as it was, it actually achieved its purpose. It brought people together and started setting up the Auckland Transport Alignment Project, which is a combined deal between council and government. The water quality targeted rate is saying, let's fix our water issues in Auckland. It's a 10 or 15 year program, but it's targeted. That money that goes in there is targeted to that. When that solution is delivered is when that targeted rate will stop. The environment targeted rate, exactly the same. We need a better environment. We need more trees, especially in urban areas, especially in the south and the west. We need to protect our beautiful islands of the Gulf. We need to protect the magnificent Manukau and Kaipara harbours. We need to protect our beaches. We need to protect our infrastructure. We need to protect what is important to us. And these are the reasons that the targeted rates are in place. They say that the dollars that you pay are actually hypothecated directly to that endeavour and can't be taken and swapped out to somewhere else. That's the critical point.
Thank you very much indeed. Councillor Dalton.
Thanks, Eddie. Just responding to his feedback of any value, because have councillors already made their minds up? You know, I was on a local board for 9 years, and when the community fed back on projects, it did make a difference. So we reprioritised when community gave us feedback, and I carry that same value through, and I will be listening and I will be wanting to know, because we are at a critical point. I want to know what Aucklanders think are core services for council. They're different for everybody. They are different for every politician around the table. And if people don't say what they think, then majority as always will rule. That's, you know, we've got a democracy, but we need to hear what you've got to say. It's very difficult for me to advocate a point if nobody is providing feedback. So it matters, and I would encourage everybody to contribute to the long-term plan consultation.
Thank you, Councillor Dalton. Over to you, Councillor Simpson.
Okay, I've got a question in the sidebar for me specifically, and it says, Desley Simpson referenced the savings due to a better operating model. Is there anything that we can see that explains the underlying facts and how the improved operating model has delivered these savings? Look, I'm really happy to answer that because I know this kind of really well. So council is now operating $316 million a year less than it was for the same level of service in 2011 and 12. That combined level of savings is $1.9 million over the 10 years. So what are some of the things that we've done before and that we're looking forward that we're going to do? So one of the recent things we've looked at is the merger of two CCOs, the RFA, the Regional Facilities, and ATED. And that merger, which was part of our CCO review, is saving us between $5 and $7 million per annum. We've also taken on quite a lot of savings from our healthy waters in sourcing experts rather than using consultants. And on that, we're doing a lot more around improved contract management around that. We are trying to insource more. Look, that means an increase in staffing numbers, but actually means a savings overall. We've made some savings from insurance claim management. And we're using IT quite a bit too to get our operation a little bit smarter. And an example of that is how we've automated our vehicle tracking to improve the efficiency of our regulatory fleet. So those are just a couple of little examples that we've done operating-wise to be a little bit more efficient. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Simpson. I'm wondering if Councillor Henderson would like to get in here. I know that he's got a young one that he needs to attend to. So Councillor Henderson, if you're there, just chime in when you are able to. I've got a comment here, or a question, and it's very much in line with a lot of the sentiment revealed last year at the emergency budget webinar. And that is the salaries of staff at Auckland Council. Now, thinking about the deficit of $1 billion and potentially Councillor Cashmore, I know that you spoke to this last year. There is a lot of feedback. If you cut council staff salaries, you'll be able to claw back that $1 billion. Is that the case, Councillor Cashmore?
So that's a work in progress. So everyone was given the opportunity, and the council staff and the elected members, to take salary cuts. I think virtually every councillor took 10%, the mayor and I took 20% cut. Some of the ELT have taken 20%, and others at Crown Council have taken 10% pay cuts. So there's the very real endeavour there. Some don't have the ability because they've got big mortgages to pay or other financial commitments. However, I think Desi also touched on it too. Sometimes the council salary package or the number of people we employ is directly relative to what the services we deliver. For instance, let's say we bought animal management back in house, I think in 2013 or 14. It saved $1 million a year, but added to our employee numbers, but it did save $1 million a year and is continuing to do so. Desi talked about stormwater. Definitely, same thing. We've taken a long-term contract on our legal services. That's being currently reviewed, and that's taken some big savings as well. So, but the fact that we can take long-term chunks of procurement brings through long-term savings. Sometimes if you bring people back in-house, that makes savings. And consenting and resource consenting is a very true point of that. So it's very simplistic just to say, oh, we've got too many staff and you pay them too much. The end of the day is, it is the service that's delivered and how effective that is and value for money that is. That's the most important outcome. Thanks, Eddie.
Thank you, Councillor Cashmore. I'm now looking around the screen to any of our elected members. Councillor Fletcher, are you wanting to get in? Go ahead.
I just want to add to what Bill Cashmore has said, and that we only employ, as councillors and elected members, we only employ one person, and that is our CEO. And I want to highlight the fact that we have a new CEO. He is utterly committed to the objectives that we have set him. He is committed to a more efficient operating model, and I'm watching with great interest as to see how he will come to us and offer up a little more than we've currently got. The other thing that I'm looking to him to do is to be as frank and fearless in the options that he puts to us in the future in terms of how we can leverage off the balance sheet somewhat better going into the future. Because even if we pass this budget, even if we ratify it with the increases that we have, it still doesn't really come to grip with the challenges we've got facing us. So we do need to find some circuit breakers, not the least, as I touched on before, the importance of pushing central government into a better financial partnership. But we're also going to have to look at other things. So our relationship with our CEO is utterly fundamental. I think he's a good guy. He's a calm, unflappable kind of person, and he's well acquainted with the challenges that we've got before us.
Thank you, Councillor Fletcher. We'll go Councillor Coombe and then
Councillor Delta. And he's paid less than the guy before him.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. There are a few questions coming through around how we're funding transport projects, for example, getting the what was known as the Sky Path over the Harbour Bridge. That is now a government-funded project. So government has investing, I think it's about $320 million in that project. And all the details can be found on the website, the Waka Kotahi website, under the Northern Pathway New Walking and Cycling link. And in terms of government investment, I mean, that's what we're trying to improve our situation by tapping into all the sources of funding that's available. So the majority of our transport projects are funded 50% by government, and that includes funding for our cycleways. So we do have investment to continue in our cycleways. And if we didn't have that in the budget, then we wouldn't be able to tap into the government investment that's available. So I think there was a question about whether that's still a priority. Well, absolutely it is, to continue building the cycle network, not just in the city centre, but extending across Auckland. And there's quite a few projects that we've got underway and looking to deliver into the future.
Thank you. Councillor Dalton.
Thanks, Eddie. I just wanted to add on to Councillor Cashmore and Fletcher around the salaries. We're one of the biggest employers in Auckland, if not the biggest. We're a multi-billion dollar organisation. If we don't employ the right people with the right skill, it will cost the ratepayers more money. And so it's important that we do have the right people doing the right job. And these people will be earning less at council than they will in the market. And so they do it for the right reasons for themselves. They want to serve their communities. They don't want to be elected. Completely understand that. But we must pay for the skill that we need to do the best job we can to comply with legislation, to comply to our responsibilities as a council. We also employ many people, possibly everyone on this call now, on the Skype or Zoom, will know somebody who works for council. And it could be in any particular role. And at the moment, we're going through restructure, and these people are losing their jobs too. You know, we've got 1,000 people, maybe more, losing their jobs. So when we talk about salaries and the cost that council has to a community, it's very difficult for everyone, councillors, community and employees. So I think it's sometimes a little difficult to get into that conversation because it looks like we're all on the pig's back. You don't actually get rich from being a politician at the end of the day. But appreciate that there's a lot of people hurting out there, but let's keep in mind the people that we employ and the ones that are having to sacrifice their roles as well, and the need for us to do our job efficiently, effectively, and at a good cost to the council.
Thank you very much indeed. Looking at Councillors Simpson and Fletcher, a lot of the commentary tonight speaks. My apologies. A lot of the commentary tonight speaks about the fact that the fiscal constraints that we're currently under mean that we have to tighten our belts. Every dollar must count. It must be maximised. So the question is, what are we doing to make sure that our spending is fit for purpose? What are the checks and balances going forward on every dollar that comes in henceforth? And it dominates a lot of the commentary that I'm reading tonight. Everybody has to do more with less. How do we at Te Konihiro Tāmaki Makaurau ensure the ratepayers and also our community that every dollar is not only going to where it's going, but there's a check and a balance that we say that we do what we say we will do? Councillor Simpson or Fletcher?
I'm happy to help with that. I mean, at the end of the day, it is really the chief executive's role to do that. From a governance perspective, we are asking for efficiencies and value for money in everything we do. And then it's up to our employee or our chief executive to deliver that through the organisation. Look, we do have a special committee on value for money now, and it's been a bit skew-whiff. It's actually been embraced as part of the Finance and Performance Committee due to the very tight fiscal constraints we have around COVID-19. But that's a special committee that has been set up to absolutely look at the value for money deliverables and opportunities for council.
Thanks, Eddie. I think it's a great question, and Desley has quite properly answered it in terms of Jim Stabek and all of the staff of council. But where we are responsible in a policy sense is the parameters that we actually want to put around ourselves in terms of what activities do we actually want to fund. And so it takes us back to the very beginning. We've actually got the opportunity through this budget to really think hard. And if I look at the wider context of the governance structure that we work, we have all the local boards, we have the wards, And what we've been trying to grapple with for some time is to look at all of the sporting facilities and activities. You're not going to have a hockey turf in every single local board area. We probably can't in every local board area have swimming pools. So it's about making sure that there is equity across the region in terms of those services and saying, well, these are the things that irrespective of where you live in Auckland, that they are the things that we want for our communities, but then delivering them in such a way that they're not gold-plated, that they are fit for purpose, and that they are not duplicating services that are immediately nearby. And those are really challenging debates to have, but that's where we must sit in a governance role. And a lot of the work on amalgamation, we still have to yet complete.
Thank you both. I've got Councillor Henderson wanting to get in.
Yeah, hello. So I've seen a question on borrowing. Now that's a bit of a tough one because local government has a different operating model to central government in terms of borrowing. We actually have a debt limit. So when times are tough, there's only so much we can borrow up to a certain point. And this budget proposes moving to 290% of our borrowings. So so basically in terms of the question of haven't we borrowed enough, well, whenever you're borrowing something, you're actually kicking it down to future generations to pay it back. So you have to be very careful in terms of what you are borrowing. While at the same time, people are expecting to maintain a certain level of services in terms of building infrastructure. And we build our infrastructure through borrowing, through our capital spends. So like everything, there is a balance there to be made. And again, that's what part of why we consult is to get a sense of where that balance is for people.
Thank you, Shane. I've got a supplementary now that we've got you there. And the question is, or the comment is the question, I'm impressed by the reiteration of the we want to hear from ratepayers, but all my prior experience is that council consultation is not genuine. So the question, councillor, is what has changed? How is this consultation different?
I think the premise of the question is that they've never been genuine, and I would actually challenge that. Councillors discuss these submissions, we eventually vote on these submissions, and we all read these submissions. So in fact, we do pay very careful attention to what you're saying. And none of us go into this process with a fixed mind. We all come with an open mind and ready to be convinced on what your viewpoints are. And I know that's how all of our councillors operate, and it's certainly how I operate. So I think it's very important that we put our submissions in, and this is all part of the process. And I just really thank everybody for attending. It's something that we've all got a lot out of so far as well.
Thank you, Councillor Henderson. There are a couple of questions here, and if I group them and elicited what the core premise of them is, councillors, have we exhausted every avenue? Isn't there some assets that we've got that we can sell off? And there's a comment in here about selling airport shares. There's also another comment in here about Tauranga has effectively floated the shares in the ports and things like that, and it's been successful. Not quite sure about the accuracy, but you know, you can see that our attendees this evening are thinking of other ways, non-rates increases ways to claw some of that $1 billion deficit back and so on and so forth. Councillors, and this is the first thing, have we considered every potential avenue, or have we just gone, well, the tried and true is rates it is? Councillor Dalton, I'll come to you.
I think that one thing that we haven't nailed yet is how we can access the facilities on school grounds. So these assets belong to the taxpayers, which are us. And there are pools, there are gymnasiums, there are sports fields, there's no end of assets that we could be sharing with our community. And that would prevent council from having to continue to think about building new assets. There's multiple dimensions to that, and that is getting community onto school grounds where there are barriers in the south, there are barriers to getting our people onto school grounds, our family, our whānau. And that is just an, you know, we could break that down by opening up these facilities. They can be used for organised sport. So if the deal was that council need to consider how it could fund some operational costs around security or renewals, it is certainly a lot cheaper than having to build these new assets ourselves. I think it's an opportunity that we just haven't been able to broker, and that's a conversation that needs to continue to be had. And that's one way that we can reduce our debt levels in terms of assets going into the future, and be a return on investment to both the ratepayer and the taxpayer.
Thank you, Councillor Dalton. I'm going to come across to Councillor Cashmore in terms of, have we exhausted every avenue? Have we left no stone unturned? And then I'll come to Andrew Duncan, who wants to get in. I just want to make a comment for our attendees or our viewers. I appreciate your patience. We've got well over 100 questions in the Q&A function. Again, we will prepare a response to every question. We'll have them uploaded to the website. You'll appreciate that we're trying to group these up so that we can address some of them, a couple of them all in one go. But I do appreciate your patience. And as you've heard this evening, the elected members are indeed looking at the Q&A machine, and they're also trying to pick up these questions of yours as well. Councillor Cashmore, have we left any stones unturned?
Depends what you mean by unturned, or what the question you mean by unturned. If we look at our key plate silver assets, the port and Auckland International Airport, they have traditionally returned us very solid dividends. Not so much at the moment, because you know COVID has knocked that stuff around pretty badly, and the port's going through a major recapitalization as far as automation is concerned. So yes, that's hurting, and we've lost, you know, over the next 4 years, it's going to be $460 million we project in lost dividends from those assets. But in the past, they have returned well. But it's a really crucial debate, because once you sell them, you're probably never going to be able to buy them back. And we need to think long and hard about that. I'm not denying it's one of the balls that's in the air that we have to think about. But is it an area which I want to go to at this point in time? I'm seeing them as that is our last-ditch insurance policy, those assets, and I would like to retain them. Potentially we could, but I will take advice and guidance from our communities and from our experts and my fellow councillors around that. As there are other stones, there's always going to be stones that we can turn over. And it's a matter of what's acceptable. Do we charge groups who use our community facilities and sports fields a higher lease or a rental rather than just a dollar a year? And do we bring in other charges that reflect user pays and help change behaviour, such as congestion charging? Do we look at fuel tax and that to incentivize people to go more to electrics? There's a whole raft of issues to face here, and none of it's simple, and it all has upsides and downsides. And some of those things we can introduce, you would hurt the most vulnerable in our community, and that's not fair or equitable either. So I think the councillors look about, okay, what can we do to progress the economy of Auckland? What can we do to grow employment? What can we do to grow equity and fairness? And what can we do to make Auckland a better place for Auckland, for New Zealanders, and internationally? And it's a very challenging question at times, Eddie, and it's there are no simple answers out there. There are simplistic solutions, but they often have countervailing hits that aren't fair or equitable. So, yeah. It's a lot to weigh up here, and this is probably one of the most important LTPs or recovery budgets that we've ever seen at this council and in this country's history, quite frankly, at the scale that Auckland is now for New Zealand. Thanks, Eddie.
Thank you, Councillor Cashmore. I'm going to go to Councillor Fletcher and then to Andrew, but I'm also going to ask the elected members to help the MC out a bit and just quickly check the Q&A machine if there's any questions that you're happy to pick up or help me address before we wrap up. That'll be fantastic. Councillor Fletcher, over to you.
I just want to touch on the fact that whenever we've tried to have a debate on some of these big strategic assets, we are told, because we are a creature of statute, that we can't do it in the consultation for that particular annual plan or that particular long-term plan. And that is a source of some frustration. And I think it makes it difficult, getting the advice from the officers, because they'll say, well, you can't do it because of some statutory restraint. I'll just park that for a moment and then add to what Bill has said. I think it's time for some really big ideas and fresh thinking. I am in a ward where there are a lot of people who have lived in their houses for a long time, and because of the increase in valuations, they're going to be facing some pretty hefty rates coming up. And that's really hard because their income hasn't necessarily increased. And I have a real difficulty with the way in which we have capital value being the basis for rates. But I'd like to, instead of just battling on that, I'd like to challenge the government. Where are they with the congestion charging? Where are they on some of these big items that will make a fundamental difference in delivering the infrastructure that we must have? So again, it's coming back to the right partnership between central government and local government. And at the moment, it's a bit disjointed. So COVID is obviously absorbing all of us. We want Auckland to survive. We want, and New Zealand won't survive unless Auckland survives. But that is not an excuse for not dealing with some of these other pieces of legislation that we need, and that we're poised and ready to go and can actually accommodate that growth going into the future. But that's probably the subject of another webinar. Thanks, Eddie, for letting me chip in.
Thank you, Councillor Fletcher. Andrew, we'll come to you now for a comment.
We had a question earlier about borrowing. I think I'd like to add something to the answer that Councillor Henderson provided. Many of the investments that we've talked about tonight that the council's planning in the next 10 years are for assets that will last 20, 30, 40, 50 years. And many of the assets we enjoy now haven't lasted that long. One of the reasons the council borrows is if we're borrowing money to invest in an asset that lasts 30 years, we'll pay that back over a 30-year period. So the benefits we get from that asset we'll get every year for 30 years. By borrowing and paying that back over time, ratepayers pay each year for the benefits they get for it over the time period. If we funded those assets out of cash, that'd be getting paid for by current ratepayers, and yet the benefits extend over a much longer period. We're also, just thought I'd make a side comment, we're also coming up to a revaluation that will come into effect, not for the year we're talking about here, but for the following year. So when your property goes up in value, it doesn't necessarily affect your rates. If everyone's property goes up by the same amount, their rates will be going up by the same amount. Our valuations are how we share the rates burden across the city. So by more than the average, they'll get more than an average increase. And if some go up by less than the average, they'll get less than the average increase. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. I've got a question here, and this can be, I guess, any of the councillors, if you'd like to chime in on this one. There's a lot of questions or a lot of feedback around, we're investing more in buses, but no one rides them. We're investing a lot in cycleways, but not everybody uses them. And you'll appreciate if you look at the question machine, it's quite a common kind of a theme. And I guess I'm starting to think about the vision that we've got for Tāmaki Makaurau being a vibrant city that's accessible with everybody being quite active. Any of you elected members have any comments to make about that? Let's go to Councillor Coombe.
Thank you, Eddie, for bringing those questions together. As a council, we're very much committed to a connected and accessible Auckland for everybody. And that involves investing in transport choice for everyone. So even if you're a car driver and don't want to use the bus or don't want to get on a bike, motorists benefit from that investment because it means there'll be more capacity on the roads. So at the moment, well, historically, Auckland has invested very heavily in our roading network, and now we're looking at more investment with the government in our public transport, in the CRL, which is really going to make a huge difference for Aucklanders right across the region in terms of accessing the airport, investment in our train stations. We're about to get a fantastic new link to the airport on electric buses from a new Puhonui station. So all of those, you know, transport investments really help Auckland get Aucklanders moving, however they need to travel. So it's really important that we invest widely in our transport network, just not in one mode. So I hope that brings together a few of the questions that have been asked. But again, I would say, you know, this is why we're doing this consultation process. You know, we're wanting to know what are the priorities of Aucklanders. And over the almost 11 years I have been on council, hearing very strongly that Aucklanders do want transport choice. And I think that this is what this budget is looking to address.
Thank you, Councillor Coombe. I've got a supplementary comment from Councillor Henderson, and then we'll come to Councillor Simpson about the targeted water rate issue. We'll come back to you in a moment, Councillor Henderson. Councillor Simpson.
Oh, thanks, Eddie. Look, I thought seeing this webinar was on rates, I should mention a couple of things on the real dollar value. I want to mention first about the water quality targeted rate. So the options in the consultation document on the water quality targeted rate are, first, should we extend it another 3 years? So to get 10 years of the water quality targeted rate. And then there's another option is should that be increased to deal with the next two large water problems that Auckland has. So for the last 3 years, we've taken a water quality targeted rate from ratepayers, and in the main, that has been put towards what they call the Western Isthmus. You know, one of the most, the worst water quality issues around Herne Bay, St Mary's Bay, etc. As you know, we're building the big central interceptor through there, and the water quality targeted rate has almost looked at the central interceptor as a motorway and looked at the on and off ramps towards that, which actually help improve the water quality in that part of Auckland. But if that rate was only extended, which was in the original mayoral proposal for 3 years, we would not be able to do any further water targeted investment for at least 6 years, all right? So by adding an additional increase to the water quality targeted rate of $3.30 for the average residential ratepayer, that would bring forward two very, very large water projects. One is what they call the Eastern Isthmus Water Quality Improvement Program, and that really deals with Parnell all the way through to Glendowie, the Tamaki River, the Waitemata around there, Hobson Bay, and it begins to address the poor water quality around there. I mean, in Hobson Bay, they've got signs there all around Hobson Bay at the moment. It's a health risk. You can't swim in it. It's really, really bad. But concurrently, we are also being able to, if the increase happens, be able to look at the improvement of water quality in the Manukau. So this is an option that I'm really keen to hear from ratepayers, is how important do they believe improving of the water quality, and do they think that investment in those two large areas should happen sooner than in waiting for another 6 years? And if so, are they prepared to pay that increase of 5%, which would be $3.30 for the average ratepayer? Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Simpson. We'll come now to you, Councillor Henderson. Welcome back.
Yes, thank you. My apologies. I got kicked off the stream and I've just got back on. Yeah, look, just briefly on public transport. I was a kid in the 90s in West Auckland. I know a lot of you will remember how horrible our public transport system truly was. Disrepair, low patronage, frequency was horrible. Even the train stations were full of graffiti. So we have made huge advantages in this as a city, and many of the residents in my ward say there's actually much more needed to meet the poorly served parts of Auckland. But if I think I took a poll on this chat, I think nearly all of us would say, look, you guys have to do something about congestion. It's out of control. I want to spend more time with my family and less time commuting. And I feel the same way as well. When we get a proper public transport system and proper cycling infrastructure so people feel safe, that actually means less cars on the road for people that have to drive. So it's part of a transport network that works a lot better for Aucklanders.
Thank you, Councillor Henderson. Councillor Delton.
I just wanted to acknowledge the comments regarding nobody using cycleways and not many people on buses, and that's a fact. And we haven't done a great job, and we've got a long way to go. And I just wanted people who are on the Zoom to understand or know that we do have these robust conversations around the council table. So we're all on the same page in terms where we want to get to, and acknowledge that perhaps we haven't done so well getting to the point we are at the moment. Agree with Councillor Henderson, the bus timetables have improved and there is more consistency. Still not a lot of people on those buses in my particular area, and some even going around empty, and absolutely nobody on our cycle lanes because they are unsafe. And a lot of money has gone into these projects with little return, and I can completely understand the frustration. So a goal for this council is to do a much better job and to get some safer cycleways in and get some, you know, we talk about the transition for lower income communities in particular to be able to transition to electric cars, to public transport. You have a big family, you can't just catch a bus in the morning and do all your drop offs. So those are the conversations that we have, and between the 21 of us we get more informed and we get better at our decision making. So thank you, Eddie, just wanted to add to that conversation.
Thank you, Councillor Dalton. I've got a comment from Andrew here, and I just wanted to give a heads up to Councillor Cashmore that there is a question in here about rural rates and the provision of services. If you could probably prepare a response to that, please. Andrew, over to you. I understand there's a bit of a lag. Andrew, are you receiving this okay? You wanted to get in and make a comment, over to you.
I've seen a couple of comments about some of the participants noting the impact that the rates increases might have on them. And the council does have some options to help people who might be struggling to pay their rates. We'd very much encourage you to get in contact with our call centre. We can put in place arrangements to pay your rates over time. We also administer the rates rebate scheme by the government, which can provide some support with paying your rates. They'll pay if you qualify for the scheme. We'll organise that and you can get a rebate on your rates. And in addition, we offer a rates postponement. There's no income test for that. Any residential ratepayer can apply for rates postponement. And that allows the rates on the property to be deferred while you've got it, while you still have up to 80% equity in the property at the council's very low interest rates. This is a pretty good scheme, no tests. So if any of you would like to find out more about that, you can contact our call centre and they'll work through all of those arrangements with you. Thanks.
Thank you, Andrew. We're going to wrap this up shortly and I'm going to come to Councillor Cashmore. For our viewers or our attendees, I just wanted to clarify that there are a lot of comments that are in our Q&A section. So what we're doing is, if it is a comment, we are compiling that, we're recording that as feedback, and we're just trying to go through the questions this evening. Councillor Cashmore, there is a bit of feedback in terms of questions on our rural communities and they pay rates and that sort of thing. I guess the question is, what kind of a commitment are we making at council to serving our rural communities?
Yes, thanks, Eddie. I saw the question, I think it was from Rodney. People, a couple of points straight up front. Both big rural areas of Auckland, Rodney and Franklin, are net recipients of council rates. And that's sometimes a hard message to give, but that's the truth. But that doesn't necessarily flow back to the individual farmer or horticultural grower or kiwi fruit person or a rural business operating in those areas. A lot of those areas in the rural parts of the city were some of the most poorly provided with infrastructure legacy-wise. So Franklin Council, for instance, my ward, had the poorest water quality in Puka Cove anywhere in the country. That had to be sorted out, and Watercare spent $160 million undoing it. And the same thing with wastewater. That's been spent over $500 million in Franklin and a similar sort of amount in Rodney. These are crucial things that make all of our lives better. Our kids can go to their playgrounds and go to their parks and not worry about wastewater trickling across them. However, individual property owners who are paying rates as farmers pay exponentially rates on their sheep, their cattle, their cows, their machinery. That arguably is not correct. In places like the UK, they only pay on curtilage, so your house and buildings, not the land property. However, that's not the rules of the law in New Zealand. And we have what we have at the moment, and we are continuously working to try and bring things better. We had a big roading program in for Rodney to start getting the road sealing going faster. And we're working now at taking the shingle roads and improving them to a stage that they're ready for sealing. And that's been a work being driven by the Rokely Local Board, Rodney Local Board, and Councillor Sayers. And it's showing big dividends. But it's going to take a bit of time to roll out. And now COVID's delayed some of that, which is really unfortunate. But we did inherit a major legacy deficit in Rodney about road sealing that we have to try and solve over the coming years. You can't do it in one hit. It's just not possible. Franklin did a lot of that over a targeted rate over all rural properties to get roading sealed in a hurry, but there's still ongoing maintenance issues about because of the quality of that sealing work that was done back in those days. So, and the other big point to bear in mind is that Rodney and Franklin take a huge amount of heavy truck traffic. So out of the Franklin ward, it's 88% of Auckland's aggregate, which is the building blocks for all roading and all building housing. So it's gone from 6 million tonnes in 2012 to 16 million tonnes now. Hits those roads, places like Mill Road, Southern Motorway, heading north to build the city. And these are crucial points of infrastructure that need to be delivered. And same with Rodney, there's big landfills where there's that same 20 million tonnes go out of the city and goes into rural areas to put deposit. And those are areas we need to focus on, whether are those heavy traffic movements, to improve the quality of those roads to enable a better delivery for all of Auckland. It's a very hard challenge for rural people to get their head around the fact that they're paying a lot of rates, often the second or third biggest bill on their account, on the end of year financial accounts. But that's one of the prices that we pay for being rural. Cheers.
Thank you, Councillor Cashmore. Listen, folks, that's all we've got time for this evening. I wanted to give a big thank you to our elected members and to our subject matter expert for joining us this evening. I appreciate that not only is it a complex conversation to have, there are also lots of moving pieces and there's a lot of feedback on our Zoom webinar this evening. Biggest thanks, though, goes to our community for tuning and chiming in. We understand that there are time constraints out there and that everyone's time poor. You're juggling a lot. And again, we're in lockdown level 3. However, we genuinely do appreciate you taking time out of your evening to join us and ask questions. I also want to reiterate that the questions that were asked in our Q&A feature that weren't addressed tonight, we do promise to address them. We do promise to provide a response to them. They will be uploaded to our website. Our next webinar is climate change. It begins at 7 o'clock and you can register by going to akhaveyoursay.nz/recovery budget. We trust that you'll stay safe and well. Au mārie, have a great evening. Thank you very much indeed.